Hey, Jess Koppenbarger, Color of Volt.
Hey.
It's good to see you. You look absolutely wonderful.
Yeah, I feel
Yeah, better than yesterday.
about the same, yeah.
No.
Just
Well,
woke up, so I feel nice and sleepy.
good, good. Thanks for taking the time to do this, and I'll just go ahead and ask a couple obvious questions, get those out of the way. How long has Color of Volt been a band?
I guess 7 years,
7 years.
about 7 years. As this entity though, it's been like 6 or 7 months. I mean, not really that long at all. Whenever the Cradle was released, we kind of started up with a new lineup, and we have Brooks Tipton from Little Rock playing keys. He used to play with Unwed Sailor, and Patrick Ryan is playing drums, and he used to play with Unwed Sailor too. And a guy named Luke White playing bass, so that's kind of our lineup right now. Plus being shown, obviously.
Right. And now none of you guys live in Oxford anymore or Jackson.
Well, Sean lives right outside of Oxford in a town called Water Valley. It's like 15 minutes outside of Oxford.
So 2 or 3 years ago, if someone asked you where Color Revolt was from, you would have said Jackson, Oxford.
Yeah, I mean, I'd probably still say Jackson, just because that's probably the closest place that Sean and I, consider home still, Sean lives outside of Oxford, but I don't know if he'd consider Oxford his home, So most of his family's in Jackson and most of mine's in Jackson, so that's probably still the closest resemblance of home anymore.
Okay. Not to mention WC Don's is there, and that's pretty much.
Right. Well, the physical building is there, but they're not in business anymore, unfortunately. I think hot dogs can only take you so far in the game, so they're not putting on shows or anything anymore,
Well, let me ask you
unfortunately.
a kind of silly question, but you personally, why did you start playing music?
I don't know. I mean, I guess my parents got me a guitar when I was in sixth grade because Sean and I went to elementary school together too, and they had like electives, and it was either stock market or guitar classes. So I learned like the basic guitar classes, and by the end of the semester, you had to write like a chord structure, or by the end of the school year, you had to write like a chord structure, and so that's kind of where it started. And then I had some like silly, kind of like kidding around bands in junior high with some of my friends. Like I had a band before I started playing with Lynn and Jimmy. I had a band called Fatso, Phatso. That was our band name was Fatso. We were pretty progressive, I mean,
Sure.
really ahead of our time. Yeah, a lot of Foo Fighters covers and Silverchair. It was pretty awesome. I think we did an STP cover too, so
Good.
we were awesome. And then yeah, I started playing with Lynn and Jimmy in ninth grade, and then we started Fletcher, I guess right before 10th grade, and then started touring with Fletcher, because we made an album in 10th grade, and then we made another album. We went and recorded with Matt Goldman. Matt Goldman.
Yeah.
We made an album with him in 11th grade, and that was kind of the end of Fletcher. And, we kind of like toured around with that, until I guess college, when we, met up with Sean and turned it into Color Revolt. So a lot of those old Fletcher songs, kind of like Homes or Graves, which is on the EP, that was kind of written as a Fletcher song and then turned into a Color Revolt song. So.
Right. Well, I remember Fletcher. I think that's we met. You were still in high school, I think.
Yeah.
Rome, Georgia, maybe
Yep.
2002.
Yeah, that was a senior. Yeah, I was a senior in high school. Yeah, because we were doing shows with Onofalo, and you put on that show at Rome, and that's when That's when we met. And then were we Fletcher when we went to, where was that? Jackson, Tennessee, or Johnson City?
Yeah.
Johnson City? Is that Fletcher?
Maybe the first time. Not the time that we played that show that we weren't supposed to play.
Right, right.
Or at least
it's like
as far as
snowing
that
happens. Or something. It was like January, right?
Yeah.
Really cold.
Something like that. It was cold, and Lynn made friends with a homeless guy and gave him a harmonica.
Yeah, I think that's right.
Maybe.
I think that's right.
You guys just released your second full-length album, The Cradle.
Yeah.
And, I mean, how do you feel about that in comparison to previous releases?
It's pretty similar, you know, in the way that it was recorded and how we went about writing it. Well, the writing process was different from any of the other ways we had written songs, because it was mostly just me and Sean.
Right.
And most of it was written either on one acoustic guitar or two acoustic guitars or piano, you know. So we had to, there was a lot of like transposing from how is this going to sound with like a real band, you know. And then we wrote, I mean, all those songs, there was one or two that were kind of older Colorable songs, but then we wrote a lot of those in the practice space with like Daniel Davison and,
right.
and Brooks. And basically me and Daniel and Brooks and Sean, like fleshing all these songs out. And then we recorded it kind of in a shorter amount of time than we did Plunder, which was 2 weeks. But this one was 1 week, but we didn't have like school or work to go to after we recorded. You know, it was kind of one session. So it went pretty smooth, but everything was tracked mostly live and onto a Neve console, you know, the same way that Plunder was recorded. So, you know, there's some similarities in the way it was recorded, but pretty different in the way it was written. So a lot of the songs at their essence are pretty soft, you know, acoustic or piano, but then kind of turned into Colorable songs, which
right.
I liked it better that way because it opened it up for more ways to, you know, add things in, or, you know, there was a lot more space in the way that we wrote the songs.
Cool. Well, I would imagine it'd be a lot different with just you and Sean, and not being able to turn a song into a full song until really, I guess, right before you recorded it.
Yeah, I mean, we made demos. We did one demo in process in Como, Mississippi, where Lynn played, and then Sean and I would just play all the bass parts. And we probably did like 18. No, we did like 20-something songs.
Wow.
We demoed out like 20-something songs with Lynn. And then that was kind of trying to prove to Fat Possum that we were still a band, you know. And just because we had lost two guys, you know, we could still make it work, you know. And then when they kind of heard the demos, they weren't into it, or they were just kind of like, yeah, we don't want to do another thing. And that's kind of when Lynn was like, yeah, I don't want to try and search for another record label or like restart, you know, this band, you know. So for a while, we just kind of ditched everything, and we weren't really going to do Colorable anymore. But then we decided we have all these songs. They're basically written, you know, and we can find people to work on them with us. And that's when I called Brooks to see if he'd do keys on anything we did. And then I called Daniel. And that's actually, Brooks suggested Patty back then, too, to possibly play on it. But I'd known Daniel. I'd seen Daniel. And I knew that Daniel was a Colorable fan, so.
Sure. But you guys are Daniel fans.
Yeah, exactly, and we're big Daniel fans. That's fun.
Cool. So what's the, where did those 18 demos disappear to?
They're all in the archive. I mean, some of them we actually started working on, you know, for the EP, and they never actually got fleshed out, and some we tried to keep working on them for, Plunder, and it just never really worked, because Plunder was, you know, all guitar album. Like, there was no keys on it or anything like that. So a lot of them, you know, never really got finished. And so we got to pull them back out for this and see if it actually worked and if it made sense. And some of them did, some of them didn't, you know, like, and then we got to try, like, newer songs, you know, that Sean and I had just recently written. And so
I'm really,
there's
really.
still a lot of songs out there that are just not finished, you know.
That's a good
We'll
problem to
probably.
have.
Yeah. I mean, we have a lot of songs in the bank or whatever, you know, but we'll see if they get fleshed out. And, well, I mean, we already have like a lot of new songs too, you know, so just waiting to see what we want to do with them, I guess.
I mean, Weezer had a lot of songs in the bank too, and then most of them sucked, so you know,
Yeah,
it's
it seems like they're still putting those out, maybe.
yeah,
I'm not
they
really
are. Unfortunately, it's good to hear all the, you know, when you guys put out an album that's full of old songs, they're all
Yeah.
good songs still. They're not just crummy songs that you.
Yeah, I mean, we try to make them, even if they are old songs, we try to make it make sense with the newer songs too, you
Right.
know, so.
Well, I gotta say that, you know, obviously I've been a fan since forever. Well, actually, I want to get back to the Fletcher thing. Fletcher started in ninth grade, right?
Yeah, driver's ed, ninth grade.
Right, I'm pretty
I
sure.
asked Jimmy, yeah, I asked him if I could join in driver's ed.
It was called Driver's Ed then?
No, that's, we were actually in driver's ed
Oh.
class, and I leaned over to Jimmy and asked him if I could join his band, and he
Right.
said
So the B-sides Fletcher album will come out in sometime 2012 after the
yeah,
apocalypse.
probably 2012, yeah.
And it'll
Yeah,
be
I'll have
called
to
Driver's
discuss
Ed.
with me on the legal rights of how we want to distribute the large amount of funds that'll be
Right.
flowing in. We'll let you know.
So ninth grade, if you graduated in 2002, let's see, I should have done the math before this, but so ninth grade would have been 99.
Yeah.
99
Yeah,
is.
I followed the years pretty close there.
So 2000, here we are 2011. So basically this band in one shape or another has been your life for 12 years going on.
Yeah, me, I mean, touring, I've been touring since 2000, so yeah.
Right. Wow,
Yeah.
so at least 11 years on the road.
Yeah.
Huh. A lot of
And
things
a
have
lot of that
happened.
was, it started out, you know, when Drew, his parents had the Honey Baked Hams band, and we used to tour in that and borrow the Lynn and I were both in Boy Scouts, so we used to borrow the Boy Scouts trailer and put it on the back of the Honey Baked Hams van and go down to like Biloxi, Mississippi, or like, you know, do you know Bill Peden? He used to book a lot of shows for us down there, and down in Louisiana, that we used to play with that band As Cities Burn, tour
Yeah.
around with them, and yeah, back in the old school days.
That's funny. So 12 years, give or take, and things are way different now than they
Yeah, a
were
little bit.
then. I mean,
Yeah.
not just you personally, or the guys that you've played with. You know, obviously the band looks a lot different now. You would really be the only person left that was there then.
Fletcher, yeah. Yeah, from Fletcher, I'm the last one standing, I
Even the
guess.
first
I don't know
lineup
if
of
that's a
Color Revolt, because you guys were Color Revolt before Sean was in Color Revolt.
Well, that's kind of when the transition happened. It was like we recorded a lot of. We were gonna put out a Fletcher EP, and you know, like which basically is what turned into the Color Revolt EP, and it had like a different version of like Friends Don't Speak on it, and what else? Paris was on it.
Yeah, it's three songs.
Yeah, well, those were the original. Yeah, exactly. Those are the three song. We did the three song, and you had that, right? It was just like a burned CD, like
Yeah, with a sticker on a white case. I think I still have a
and
stack of
then.
those stickers. And S.
Somewhere.
Yeah, somewhere. I was trying to find one the other day to put on Claire's Barbie Jeep, and
Nice.
I couldn't find it. But they're around here somewhere. Not too
Yeah.
long ago. But,
Yeah, I mean, we had that, we wrote a lot, and I think New Family might have been on there too. And then we wanted to, I'm not sure how we asked Sean to join the band. I think like what happened was his band broke up. He was in a band called City Lights, and we just kind of thought like, why is this guy, you know, this guy's got to be in a band, you know, if not any band, he needs to be in our band. So, you know, we only had two guitar players, we might as well have another one. So,
Right. He added a lot, too.
yeah, I mean, Sean's, you know, one of the most unique guitar players. So it wasn't like, oh, well, let's add another guy to just double, you know, my guitar parts or Jimmy's guitar parts. So,
His vocals changed everything.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
I mean,
So.
that really developed that whole style of constant, almost constant falsetto harmony,
Yeah.
and of course his guitar playing and everything. But now I want to ask you about touring now. Back then, Fletcher, 12 years ago, whatever, it was gas prices have tripled since then.
Yeah, they have. I remember we used to pay, I remember paying 90 cents a gallon
Right.
when we first started touring. And I could fill up my car, I have a little car, I could fill up my car for about 17 or $18, and now it's like closer to 30.
Well, so gas prices have tripled. People don't really buy CDs that much. They might buy vinyl. A lot of people are just downloading albums for free.
Yeah.
It's not cool to wear your favorite band's t-shirt anymore. I mean, there's
Unless you're on tour with them and you can wear it on stage
right.
because you're on tour with them, you do the
Three or four
t-shirt
nights in a
swap.
row. Three or four nights in
Yeah.
a row. But so really, financially, how does it make sense for you guys? How do you make money? How do you survive financially?
I mean, really now it's just trying to break even, everything, basically is free now and you give everything away. I mean, you're making money off digital sales mostly. But touring, you don't really make much money touring. I mean, with gas and we all live in different cities, so we meet up either here in Nashville or in Memphis and we practice for, a day or two and then we go on tour from there, and it just kind of depends on what the routing is. Like in these next shows, we're coming to Columbia first, so we'll probably meet up in Memphis and practice for a couple of days, and then go up to Columbia. But I mean, really, I don't know. I mean, we don't really. We just try to break even. I mean, we
Right.
don't have any sort of money making schemes or anything. I mean, it probably would be smart if we did, but we don't really. I mean. It's just breaking even. I mean, you just kind of hope that, your guarantee or whatever covers your gas prices. And we got a Taco Bell endorsement, for the last tour, so we used a lot of Taco Bell bucks for food. And
Right.
we try to, if we stay in a hotel or something, we try to use, like have a AAA card, and then we send Sean in and tell him that we need the military discount, because he looks pretty official. And that, I mean, we just try to cut corners as much as possible. I mean, not really, but we try to not stay in hotels, that's for sure. Yeah,
And that
just
basically means that you love what you're doing so much that you're willing to break money or break even or lose money to do it.
yeah. I mean, for a while, like when I lived in Oxford, I tried to get away with not having a job and living off, whatever Color Revolt made, and it was just not happening. I mean, I would work small jobs here and there and make, ends meet, but I moved up to Nashville and had to get a job, and now I work two jobs actually, and it's just kind of like I don't make any money from Color Revolt. I do it because it's like what I do. It's like you said, it's like this is what I've done for, the last decade, so I'm gonna keep doing it because it's what I like to do. I like to play in a band. I don't know. I don't really see myself doing anything else right now. So this is, what I like doing musically. I'm not really into techno or anything like that. So maybe one day I'm gonna do techno and do a techno album or something. We'll see. Something digital maybe.
Well, you have worked on a solo album.
Yeah, I have a solo album coming out this year. I'm not sure. It'll probably either be April or May before it comes out, and then I'll probably do two tours before it comes out, and then a tour after. But it'll kind of be juggling that and Color Revolt, So, I mean, it's basically, I mean, that record's just like basement recordings that I did in Oxford for the better part of the last decade too. I mean, I started it in 2003 and finished it in 2009, so.
But what I've heard of it is really good, so I think that you'll get a lot of support on that.
Yeah, I'm excited about it. I mean, Chaney's putting it out, and it'll be an Esperanza release,
And we've seen you do some of those songs here in Columbia. One of the best nights of my life.
Yeah, mine too, for sure, for sure.
Musi Reggie was there.
Right, that's when I met Musi Reggie. Yeah.
Well, let me ask you too. When you guys used to tour a lot with other bands, that doesn't really happen too much anymore. It's just kind of impossible to even break even doing that. But I mean, early on,
Yeah.
there was, a lot of camaraderie between you guys and bands like Onofalo or Manchester Orchestra. How are you guys affected now by? When you look at bands like Onofalo, who was really, I can't speak for you guys, but for us, they were role models to us when we were.
Yeah, I mean, they were like our bigger brothers, you know. I mean, we kind of learned how to tour from them, you know,
Right. And then,
how to do it.
so you've got them that you looked up to, who were really a great band, great touring band, great live band.
Yeah.
Eventually, they, obviously have thrown in the towel.
Yeah.
And then you look at the other end of the spectrum, who is the other band, Manchester Orchestra, who you guys definitely in Onofalo took them under your wing and said, hey, this is how you tour, this is how you dedicate your life to playing music for ungrateful people. What I mean, and then of course, so you've got the two ends of the spectrum, Onofalo who's done, Manchester Orchestra who's really experiencing a great deal of success.
Yeah.
Those are the guys that you used to tour with. When you think about that, how does that affect the way you look at your band?
Well, I mean, I think you have to have a little bit of both worlds. And, you know, if you're gonna make it, I mean, you know, you got to know when to, you know, not sell out or whatever, but you gotta know when to like try and make some money from it, you know, and you gotta learn how to actually give stuff away too, you know. I mean, I feel like, you know, Onofalo is the quintessential band of, you know, doing it for the most, you know, it was everything was done with the purpose of making a perfect art, you know, and making their art the most that it could be, you know. And then Manchester is like a machine, you know. They're just like a, they have a team around them, and it's always, you know, everything's calculated. And you know, in order to make, you know, to make it work, you have to be able to do that. You know, you have to have a team. You have to have people that are looking out for your best interest and caring, you know, about, you know, because if you don't, you know, you'll end up with, you know, how we almost did, with a ton of debt, you know, to a record label. You know, and then you'll have to just fold. Just, I mean, that's how 238, I mean, one of my favorite bands, you know, it's like
Sure.
they basically broke up because they just weren't, you know, doing it in the right way of financially, and they weren't promoting themselves right, you know, or whatever. You know, they had the wrong representation on their side. And I don't know, you have to be able to balance your art and doing what you want to do, but also, you know, watching your back and taking care of yourself financially, and making sure that you can, what you want to do works for your future, you know, and planning out kind of a career, which I feel like Andy is great at that. You know, he really kind of maps out like, this is how I want everything to be, you know, and he kind of calculates it all, and he has his hands in every cookie jar, you know, and he's pushing it all along. And you know, and that's why he's successful, you know, and he's really good at what he does, and he doesn't really have, you know, a backup kind of thing. It's like, this is all or nothing, you know. He's dedicated himself pretty hardcore to that. So, you know, it's you know, that's a way to do it, you know. That's an avenue. But also, you know, I feel like Onofalo could have done the same thing. And I just feel like they had so many people in their band, and so many different creative minds that, you know, it was just one of those things where like they can push it so hard for so long. I mean, and they made two or three of the most like epic records I've ever heard in my life. So it's like how many more records can you make like this? I mean, it's like,
Well,
this was a
Dream Theater
matter.
did it.
Do what?
Dream Theater did
Dream Theater? Yeah, totally. Yeah, I mean, if Dream Theater can do it, I mean,
Right.
anybody can, yeah.
Right. Well, I want to talk a little bit about Columbia. You guys are, you mentioned earlier, you're playing in Columbia on January 20th. Is that right?
Right, yeah.
With Austin Crane's new band, Valley Man,
Valley Maker.
and a
Yeah.
band from Charlotte called Junior Astronomers, both of
Yeah.
which do really well in Columbia, and you guys do really well in Columbia. So this interview is really kind of just to catch up this new generation of kids to who you guys are and what Columbia means to you. So I really feel like Columbia has been a huge fan of Color Vault since day one, and
Yeah, for sure.
there's always a special place in our
A lot to do
hearts
with.
for you guys, and that, whether or not that makes us creepy stalkers or maybe you guys have a special place in your heart for Columbia as well. At least,
Definitely.
you and Sean, there's been a lot of things that I think that your band has experienced in Columbia. Whether it's writing songs in Columbia like we talked about earlier, or celebrating your 21st birthday in Columbia.
Yeah.
One of the most insane nights of my life. But
That actually got you fired,
you got to lose a job over something. Tell me a little bit about your history with Columbia.
I've played a lot of shows in Columbia, and I remember one of the most memorable was with Manchester, actually. It was the hottest summer, I think, on record. I think it was either 2007 or 2008, and it was 110 degrees outside, and then it was like 135 inside. So I think everybody in there, you could walk from outside inside. I mean, it was so hot outside, and then you walk inside, and it was like a sauna, and you would just immediately start sweating inside, and then like there were lights on you. So we played the whole show in shorts, and I think everybody was just soaking wet the whole time. I mean, that was one of the most memorable shows for me. Just like if you can play a show in what feels like the Mojave Desert or something, and people actually stick around and like have a good time, like that's pretty impressive, but yeah, I mean, even like playing with Austin, the last time I was there, I mean, it just seems like that Columbia just always puts out people who genuinely care about music, and they care about the art that they make, and they care about the art that other people make, and so they come to shows and really respect it and try and support it. And Columbia has always been a very supportive town of any band I've ever known. I mean, anybody I talk to that's toured through there has always said what a great town it is, and how cool everybody is there, and that everybody really respects everybody's music, and are just super nice as people to the people that come through there. And it's cool. I mean, it's a great town. I mean, with a lot of great people, and I'm excited to go back.
Good. We appreciate you
Cool.
saying that. I do want to ask. I think earlier I had to check to make sure, but you guys wrote the song "A New Family" while you were in Columbia. Is there any
Yeah.
correlation between Columbia and that song, or was that a song that you guys had just been working on?
I mean, we had worked on it, but yeah, I mean, the idea of that song definitely did come from that. I mean, we did that in I think it was your practice space,
Right.
it's just the idea of touring around and people, accepting you not only as a band and an artist, but like as a person, and letting you into their house, and feeding you and giving you a blanket to sleep under or something. That's kind of where it was this is th that was our home. And for a lot of bands, the road is their home and the van is their home, and so when you go to a new city, the only thing you experience is like, oh, well, have you been to Cincinnati or something? It's like, yeah, one person might have one view of Cincinnati and one person might have a completely different one because they played different bars and the promoter was different, and oh, well, this guy thinks Cincinnati sucks and this guy thinks that Cincinnati's awesome based on how they were treated and who they stayed with and how the reception was from the crowd that night. It's like that's really all you get, I mean, it's always a weird thing with tours. Like you have this distorted image of what a city is, but for us, you know, and for me personally, Columbia has always been the city that's always accepted us with total generosity and been very kind to us, and you know, and so we felt like that was always kind of our home away from home, you know, and we have a couple of cities that are like that, you know, but Columbia is definitely one of the farther reaching ones, you know. Once we get farther north than that, it's like we kind of, you know, think, okay, well, we're gonna have to be sleeping in hotels or something, you know, or you know, I don't know, it's one of, you know, from you and Austin and a lot of those guys, like it is, you know, I mean, that song was pretty close to, you know, there's not much give in the meaning there, you know, it's pretty set on what it is.
Well, we appreciate that. That means a lot. Well, we talked. I okayed this with you earlier. I hope it's still cool. But I was hoping maybe you could play a song for us, and then we'll let you get to your day.
Yep. Let me grab this acoustic. So this song, yeah, I mean, it was originally written like on piano. It's kind of like our, when it started, it was kind of like our Pixies rip off, you know, but just those three chords are obviously very Pixies, you know, but
Sure.
So yeah, this was New Family, and then there's the piano line just follows the vocal part. Laid my head down on your belly. I've never heard something so warm. It was blood. Solo part.
It was perfect. I couldn't have asked for more.
Sweet.
Well, listen, Columbia is really, really looking forward to this show on the 20th.
Time as well.
I look forward to seeing you guys and hanging out with the new guys and meeting them. We appreciate you catching us up to speed on what's going on. There's a lot of new kids and young kids that have absolutely no idea where you guys are coming from, because
Yeah.
they were selling diapers when it all started. Literally, I mean, think about it. 12 years ago, these kids that are 16, they were 4 then, probably still wearing diapers because they're spoiled brats,
Crazy.
right? So they should have been potty trained.
Well,
But
loud rock music is still, it's what we do best. So I think they'll enjoy it.
well, good. Well, we look forward to you guys being really loud and awesome. And I'm sure that circus is not on the set list, but if it was, you could imagine there would probably be some sort of a mosh pit, circle pit. So
You never know.
just keep that in mind.
Yeah, we will. We will. I mean, we have a very limited rehearsal plan, but I'm sure we might be able to work something up. So you never know. Keep your fingers crossed. I know I will.
Awesome. Well, we love you. It's great to see you. It's great to talk to you, and we'll see you in a couple weeks.
Love you too, Ben. Tell Jeanette and Claire I said what up.
You know I will. Have a good day, man.
Awesome.
See
All
ya.
right, you too, Ben. See you, man.